All right, I have prepared a bunch of files that I wanted to walk through now, explaining the code implementation of CNN in PyTorch. So I have a couple of files that I prepared. The first one is LINET5 implemented to classify handwritten digits in MNIST. Then I implemented a LXNet, trained on Cypher 10, and another convolutional network trained on Cypher 10. And I also have a video on saving and loading models, which I think is relatively important to you in terms of the class project. I explained that before in an earlier lecture, but I think it's a good idea to recap that. But that will be in the next video. So in this first video, let's talk about LINET 5 trained on MNIST. So just to recap how LINET 5 looks like, so this is from the slides. So for LINET 5, this was trained on a handwritten letter and digit data set. So in our case, we have only digits, but the same concept should apply. So here we have 32 times 32 inputs. MNIST is 28 by 28, so we have to make a small adjustment and resize MNIST. And then, what you can see here is it goes from one channel to six channel after the first convolution here. And then this 28 by 28 times six feature maps here, they are subsampled using pooling, and you can see now the size of them is halved. So we go from 28 times 28 to 14 times 14. And then with the convolution, the number of channels is increased from 6 to 16, and the image size decreases slightly. And then again, we have a pooling layer, which halves the size. So from 10 times 10 to 5 times 5. We keep the number of channels, and then we have these fully connected layers. You can see a pattern here that usually when we use convolutions, we try to keep the height and width approximately the same. Here it shrinks a little bit because we don't use padding, but overall the size is kind of the same as the input. However, usually with the convolution, we increase the number of channels. With the subsampling, what we usually do is we keep the number of channels and we reduce the height and width by half. Later in next week's lecture, I will also show you that we can actually do both in one step, that we can half the dimensions and also increase the channels just with convolutions, not using pooling. And there are actually a bunch of architectures that are called fully convolutional networks. So fully convolutional networks usually don't use these fully connected layers, and they don't use pooling layers. And I will talk more about that next week. But for now, let's focus on this LINET 5 here. So let's walk through this step by step. The usual watermark, importing some packages. I put some stuff here in the helper function as usual to keep the notebook a little bit more organized. Then everything here is same as usual. You may notice this may not work when you run things on the GPU. That is because some algorithms are not deterministic on the GPU. So if you have problems, an error, you can just comment this out. So I'm first resizing the 28 times 28 MNIST images here to 32 times 32. And I'm also normalizing them such that the pixels are centered at 0 and are between minus 1 and 1. That is the same as before. Let's just run this to see that it can load the data properly. That works. So this is our LINET 5 network. So I have included a variable here called grayscale, because in my implementation, I also tried this on Cypher 10, for instance, and Cypher 10 is a color image data set, so we have three channels. However, here, MNIST only has one channel, but I could toggle between one and three, depending on what the input is, so I gave it this additional parameter. I'm also saving the number of classes, because that's kind of, I wouldn't have to save that, but I need this information for the last layer, right? So, because the last layer is still a fully connected layer. If I go back one more time, so here this last one, for that I need the number of classes. All right, so now step by step, I'm using this sequential API because it's more convenient. And then just like in the figure I showed you, we have a convolutional layer with the number of input channels, 1, and this is the number of output channels, that's 6. So we're going from 1 to 6, and we have a kernel size of 5. So here, this thing here is 5 by 5. Then I have a 10H activation, the pooling layer. So the pooling layer has the kernel size of 2. We will later see also that we can actually have larger pooling layers and then use, we can, for example, have a 3x3 pooling layer and just use a stride of 2. That would also work. Then we have another convolution layer going from 6 to 16, kernel size 5, 10H layer. So you can see that's the same pattern essentially as with fully connected layers. So we have first the layer itself, which has the weights, then we have an activation function, and in this case we have a pooling function. So you can really think of this as the first block and this as the second block. So if I go back, so 1 convolution, 2 convolution. So there are essentially 2 convolutional layers. I can actually annotate it conv 1, oops, and conv 2. And then this is our feature extractor. That's why I just call it features. I mean, just some arbitrary name, but this is essentially our feature extractor. So you can think of all that part here as the feature extractor. And this is our fully connected part, which is essentially a classifier. It's similar to a multilayer perceptron. So here I have just called it classifier. And then this is like a multilayer perceptron. It receives the input. So I can, let's show it maybe here. So in the forward method is how we call these layers and everything. So first I'm calling features. So this features here will run everything here. Then I'm flattening it because this will be something times 16 dimensional 3D tensor, right? So we have height and width times 16 channels. So here what I'm doing is I'm flattening it. So what is torch.flatten will essentially make this. So let's write it down. So here this is actually NCHW format. So batch size, channels, height and width. And this torch.flatten will combine it into an N times, let's say M, where M is the channels times the H, the height times the width. So we are essentially flattening it into a vector because, yeah, as you know, fully connected layers or linear layers work with vector inputs. Okay, so is there, yeah, this is actually shown here, this flat thing. Okay, all right, so fully connected layer, this is a little bit tricky to get. So if you don't know what to put here, you can just do maybe print x.size the first time you run it, and then you can take a look at this number. Actually, this should be the number, the dimensionality that you have to put in here. So here I calculated it manually, so it's 5 times 5 times 16. So that's, if I go back here, this is, if you can see it here, 16 at 5 times 5. This is where I have this number from. Okay. And then the next dimension will be 120. That's the size of the hidden layer. So this will be this 120. Then we go from 120 to 84. This is here, this one. And then we go from 84 to the number of classes, which is 10 for MNIST. So here that's the 84 to 10. And I'm not using these Gaussian connections, by the way. So I think if you use an MSE loss function with Gaussian data, then it should be equivalent to cross entropy. It's some way you can mathematically show that. But we're not doing it here. We are just using regular softmax. So it's the more common ways nowadays anyways. So this is how we define the network module. And then here I'm initializing it. So setting it to grayscale, 10 classes, putting it onto a GPU if I have a GPU available. So if I go up again, it will here automatically choose my first GPU if I have one. I'm currently right now running this on my laptop on a CPU. So actually be just on the CPU. And then this is all the same stuff that we discussed before, all the same functions. I don't even think I made any change to those. That's exactly the same that we used in the previous lecture. So I'm using here an SGD optimizer with momentum and a learning rate scheduler. And then this is just the train model. The train model function that I imported from my train here. I can maybe just open this. So train model, this is just a boilerplate code where we iterate over the epochs and then iterate over the mini batches. We load the data, do the prediction, and have the cross entropy, and then the backpropagation. And here we update the model parameters. And then this is just logging to print some results. And then if we have a scheduler, it also updates the scheduler, and then a little bit more logging, and that is essentially it. So let's run this then. Should actually be quite quick because it's a relatively simple model. So I'm running this on a CPU, so it might take a little bit, but not too bad. All right, let me be quiet now and let this thing finish. Yeah, you can see it's training. I mean, after the first epoch, it's already 97%, but it's still going up. But you can also see it's quite overfitting. It's 99 over 98. I mean, not that much, but a little bit. Yeah, it looks good. So loss goes down. It would maybe go down even further if we would train further. But yeah, you can see based on the training and validation accuracy, maybe the validation accuracy would even go up a little bit. Training accuracy might even reach 100 if we would train a little bit longer. But I was impatient. It took already 1 minute. That's actually not too bad. All right, so I also prepared a show examples function, and this will show some examples from MNIST. So the first number P is predicted and T is the true label. So you can see it gets all of these here correct. Just always useful to double check things, whether the model gets them correct or not. All right, so this is the first video, and in the next video, I will show you the AlexNet.